लड़ाई किसी एक व्यक्ति की नहीं है, हमारी लड़ाई है न्याय के लिए और जीतेंगे भी हम लोग।
कोई संदेश?
आखिरी समय तक लड़ेंगे, आखिरी समय तक दलितों के लिए, न्याय के लिए।
गुजरात के हर एक दलित परिवार के लिए 5-5 एकड़ जमीन।
Controversial Muslim rights organization, the Popular Front of India, just days away from being banned by the union government.
Autocrats are born with the urge to suppress dissent. The current NDA regime is basically an outgrowth of Hindutva fascism. They are prone to use draconian laws to crush organizations and movements they don't like. The reason is simple. They can't use reason and truth to counter the arguments put forward by the dissenters. The present BJP government is demonizing social activists, NGOs, impartial media, progressive and minority organizations. The current vilification campaign against the Popular Front of India looks like a prelude to another phase of ban and suppression. But the country and the organization will surely overcome this phase. That is the inherent but powerful message of the response of some India's leading intellectuals and activists to the reports appearing in some print and visual media.
The present BJP government has been essentially functioning on an agenda, on a kind of fascist agenda, which is to destroy all dissent, all opposition, and therefore in that process they do several things. They first set off a social media campaign against some targeted individuals who are opposed to them, against organizations that are opposed to them. Thereafter they often hound them through various government agencies, as has been done with Citizens for Justice and Peace of Tista Setalwad or Greenpeace or many other organizations and individuals. And in some extreme cases, we have been seeing that people who are dissenters or opposed to the ideology of the BJP have also been subjected to violence, including some of them have been killed, such as Gauri Lankesh most recently, as well as Kalburgi the earlier rationalists, Dabholkar, Pansare, etc. So, this is a very, very dangerous thing that is happening in this country and needs to be stopped immediately. It must be firstly condemned by all right-thinking individuals. It must be opposed tooth and nail. People who are doing this must be held accountable and brought to book. This is a serious threat to democracy. All of us need to wake up to that.
You see, the present regime, he believes in fascism, communalism, and an unequal society. Their communalism is directed against the minorities, religious minorities, like Muslims and Christians in particular. They want always some enemies against which they will rile. And that is the only agenda they have today. They are an immature lot. And are indulging in some crazy ideas which are becoming intolerable.
Well, I have myself spoken up against this vilification campaign time and again. You see, if there are any serious charges against them, the government should proceed legally, not be seen as harassing unduly any of these organizations, not suspecting too much, and the vilification campaign must stop. and this type, the way the societal ward is being hounded. She has done excellent work. Our Harsh Mandarji, his peace march was attacked by some goons near Alwar. I condemn all of that.
Present government, as we have already experienced, is working on almost the what can be called a fascist mode, and that begins with the attack on institutions that work independently, institutions that try to help people, to tell people the truth about what's happening around, and also in some way be of service to especially the people who are suffering, the subaltern classes. This government, as we know, has already attacked various organizations which have been working for the upliftment of the poor. It began with the Greenpeace, which has done marvelous work for the cause of environment, and then it attacked Sabrang. Tista Satalwad is already known as one of the foremost activists for peace and for truth in India. And that went on to then they went on to attack INSAF. Then they went on to attack the Center for Equity Studies run by Harsh Mandar, who again is one of the most leading human rights activists in India. It seems that this attack has been going on for some time, and now it seems that they are extending their onslaught to minority organizations. Already minorities have been cornered. They have been from the very beginning treating them as the other, as outsiders, as people who have come from some other country, even though all of them were born here, brought up here, and have been living here for generations. And then they began to attack the lifestyle of the minorities, and now they have begun to talk about banning some of the organizations run by the minority religions and other minorities like the Popular Front, and banning the culture of banning itself is fundamentally undemocratic, and we would be against banning any kind of organization. And also now it looks like that any organization that does not agree with the government and its views is viewed as a terrorist, as a seditionist, as treacherous, and that is how they start their attack. And then finally they want to ban an organization and silence them.
One of the characteristics of any fascist political party is the suppression of dissent, suppression of the organizations which oppose them. And we have evidence from history, right in Italy and in Germany. The two fascist parties, when they came to power, they tried to destroy leftist parties, social democrats, and any other political movements which oppose them. And in the case of the Hindutva fascism in India, it is very clear that they are totally intolerant about dissent, and they are the people who banned quite a few organizations in the past. And when they some of the Hindutva forces make a hue and cry about the ban on the Popular Front of India, there is nothing unnatural about it, because it is a part of their political game. But we know that we will be able to overcome such threats, such oppression.
If you read Golwalkar, Savarkar and Tilak, their ideology is they are the owners of this country. They said as long as Surya, Chandra, as long as the sun and moon exist, or this world exists, they will be the owners of this country. So according to that, they have been working. I can understand not going with the independence movement, but I can't understand opposing that movement. They did not want, they only want British to rule and allow them to execute their religion. Even Mughals, with them, they have contract. They had entered into contract. Yes, you rule us, but don't interfere in our religion. British, you rule us, but don't interfere. They use all tactics. They blast bombs. They commit riots. They fight with Pakistan, as it has come to my knowledge now that Bhagwat is taking money from Pakistan. to destabilize this country. Even a prime minister at my place said that the dispute between Pakistan and India, dispute between Kashmir and India, and dispute between Hindu and Muslim in India and Pakistan is their lifeline of politics.
But what we have been seeing since, let's say, 2013 till now, the aggression in it, and quite patently the impunity in that, from journalists and writers and activists, people like me, who get also trolled, by the way, all the way to institutions, universities, political groups, ethnic groups, religious groups for that matter. And this vilification is not merely abusing them. This is targeted, and it is inciting of hate and violence. And that makes it very worrisome when vilification and when these campaigns almost call for the extinction, for the extinguishing of a persecution, of a person, or of opinion, and mostly again of the person, really, then it becomes frightening.
I think India, in the 70 years of its post-independence phase, has not faced such a situation. So there is a danger of a dictatorial government, a majoritarian government, taking over this country completely. This we have to understand. It's not only a matter of having a government or a party in government which is anti-Muslim and anti-Christian. It's also a question of having a government which has come through a democratic process, which is totalitarian in its character. So what this government is doing, it's weakening and destroying all the democratic institutions, all institutions which hold this democracy together. Secondly, democracy is not held together only by state institutions. It's the civil society organizations, it's the political parties which run this democracy and which make governments accountable and responsible to people. So the first thing that this government started doing after coming to power was to vilify these civil society organizations.
Almost 10,000 voluntary organizations, funding has been stopped through FCRA, completely based on a witch hunt with no verification or evidence. Students' movements, dissent groups, civil society groups, independent journals, social media groups, organizations, portals, which are running parallel mainstream stream of consciousness, they're all being threatened and terrorized. And in fact, they are there's always the fear that they will be stopped, blocked, arrested, jailed, condemned. So this is invisible fascism as visible fascism. This is unstated fascism as stated fascism. This is complete subversion of the Indian constitution and Indian democracy. I would say that no society in a modern context, especially a democratic, pluralist, secular society, can function by curtailing or clamping down on multiple pluralist voices.
There is clearly an attempt to destroy civil society, its work and its pillars by the Indian state. This is for a number of reasons, because the state in India is increasingly authoritarian, and along with being authoritarian, it now has an ideological bent which is right-wing, which is extremely Manuvadi or Hindutva fundamentalist, and it cannot in any way stomach the presence of alternate narratives given to their attempt to be dominant narrative of Hindutva. So they have to destroy any alternative narratives or the wellsprings of alternative narratives given by various shades in civil society. This is what the Indian state, now in collusion with the Hindutva fundamentalists, seek to do.
The question still remains, why Popular Front of India is targeted? We find that in India, which is a secular, socialist, sovereign, democratic republic, beneath the visible, beautiful state, there always functions a deep state. The reasons being projected as a justification for an imminent, we don't know how far it is imminent or not, for putting a ban on Popular Front. The incidents that are being quoted, they seems ridiculous in one word. Some of our activists, a few of our members involved in one local crime in Kerala, or two local crimes in Kerala, or such other allegations, if they take it as a grounds reason for banning an organization or controlling an organization, I think there are a lot of organizations, political parties, which are involved in such crimes, local crimes, local incidents, manifold times. If you examine the track record of creating violence, I think these Sangh Parivar organizations that stands in the forefront in crime records. So it is not the involvement of a few of its members in very few local incidents, which is already being dealt according to the provisions of law. It is the politics of the Popular Front of India on the one hand and the politics of Sangh Parivar on the other hand. That is the reason for particularly targeting Popular Front of India. Popular Front from the very inception, in addition to, along with its efforts to empower the minorities, in alliance with other marginalized sections such as Dalits, tribals, it has been giving the very clear message to the marginalized Indian Muslim community that don't get afraid of Sangh Parivar. Don't succumb to their threats. Stand up and say no. And resorts to all democratic, legal, available ways to defeat this fascist agenda and to get equal rights as equal citizens of this democratic country.
We have been implementing a model of development which is completely pro-rich, and it's creating the super-rich class. And also, that global capital has entered in a massive way, and during the last 3 years, particularly the BJP rule, I think we have opened our market, our economy completely to global capital. Our unholy alliance between the global capital driven by imperialist ambition and also the communal forces and Hindutva forces in India. Now this model of development is rooted completely in politics of hatred, because politics of solving the problems of the people and society have been relegated. Now there is a massive effort to divert the attention of the electorate of the people to issues which are completely not concerned with everyday life of the people, nor building a future where people can live in harmony, can live, you know, sort of life where human being can live as a human being. I think it is this backdrop and this context that is making the Bharatiya Janata Party and particularly Sangh Parivar forces, whose politics are completely based on hatred and such a contempt to different cultural diversities. And therefore, what they do is that they indulge in massive vilification of any activist or any dissenting voice or any diversity.
I would like to say here that the ban culture which this government has unleashed on India is condemnable, because the political ideologies need to be countered through counter ideologies. And in democracy, we respect dissent. Sometimes dissent is very, very important because it helps us grow better and become a better society.
Immediately after Modi became the Prime Minister of India, he convened a meeting of the Supreme Court judges, in which he said, actually he warned that the court and the judges should be very careful about the five-star activists. By branding as five-star activists of those organizations which are fighting for the rights of downtrodden people, he actually said, he actually instructed the judiciary that they should not show any judicial leniency towards such organizations when the present government takes action against them. Many of the organizations fighting for the downtrodden people are actually bringing out many things which are hidden by the national media. They want that such organizations which bring out the truth towards the people should be made silent. And so they are now doing such a vilification campaign.
Very definition of RSS in its own constitution says that it is an ekachalakanuvartit, I mean an authoritarian autocratic organization. How can an autocratic organization be democratic? Absolutely. I mean, when Malegaon blast investigation happened, 34 videos were recovered, rather were found on the laptop of Gayanand Pandey, the self-proclaimed Shankaracharya. He had this habit of recording every meeting that Abhinav Bharat conducted. In one of the meetings, Prasad, Lieutenant Colonel Prasad Purohit talks about an information received by military intelligence that ISI had given 24 crore rupees to Indresh Kumar, which Mohan Bhagwat and Indresh Kumar pocketed. Now, why ISI was funding RSS? To polarize Hindus.
The vilification of a particular person or an organization based on a particular community or religion or the caste is dangerous. And if it happens too often, then my country's secular fabrics are at risk. So I totally agree that this kind of vilification, this kind of targeting, this kind of lynching or killing the people who are being known as the secularist, I may not agree with them, but everybody has got a right. I am not against doing something very stupidly against the RSS or anything, because let them also preach whatever they are preaching, but they should not be getting any extra constitutional support by any government.
You see, BJP government's campaign against NGOs, against human rights defenders, against social and political organizations which don't conform with them is actually a result of the upbringing of that party. It is part of RSS. It is a subsidiary of the political wing of the RSS. So I think what they are doing is of course wrong and unconstitutional, unlegal, illegal under our present laws. My point of view is that everybody has a right to say what he wants. Even BJP and RSS people should have the right to say what they want. But once they commit a crime, they should be caught, and only that person who is committing a crime should be caught. If a person in a Muslim organization or in a socialist organization or communist organization, whatever, does something wrong, he should be punished, not the whole organization. The ban on BFI and earlier the ban on CME also was wrong.
I have come across the reports about the proposed ban of the Popular Front of India by the government of India. But I have a feeling that the government is actually taking a very wrong step here, because there has not been any evidence to prove the kind of allegations certain agencies have raised against Popular Front of India. They say that they have been connected with international terror organizations, that they have been involved in forced conversions and other kind of things. But you know, in my association with this organization and my public life in Kerala for a long time, where this organization actually started, I have never been able to see even a shred of evidence that the Popular Front of India or its any of its activists were really involved in this kind of anti-national activities or illegal activities. They have been essentially an organization for the empowerment of the minority community, that is the Muslims in India. And their activities have been essentially based on the constitutional rights available to the citizens of India. And their empowerment projects have actually had a very serious impact on the community, developing a number of institutions, a number of social uplift programs, including a very highly successful newspaper in Kerala, and educational institutions, poverty eradication programs and all that. So all these things give you the idea that this organization is really doing something like nation building, helping the minority community, the poorer sections of the minority community to come into the mainstream, and that way they are actually helping to expand the democratic base of the country. But unfortunately, the Hindutva government doesn't understand, or they are taking a wrong attitude to this. I think it's a very wrong and ill-advised move on the part of the government to ban such an organization which is doing a great service to the community, a great service to the country, and essentially doing a highly democratic, highly egalitarian culture of the society.
Koi bhi aur kisi ki bhi hukumat hai, wo aati hai dastoor ki buniyad pe, wo aati hai dastoor ki qasam kha karke. Agar wo dastoor ka lihaz aur paas nahi rakhta hai, تو دستور کی سے غداری کی جاتی ہے اور کسی بھی حکومت کوئی حق نہیں ہے کہ دستور کی خلاف ورزی کھلے طور پہ کرے کسی کو یہ حق نہیں ہے کہ ایک آئیڈیالوجی کو جو دستور نے نہیں دیا ہے اس آئیڈیالوجی پہ اگر اس کا یقین ہے تو امپوز کرے اور کسی کو بھی یہ حق نہیں ہے کہ چاہے وہ کسی بھی آرگنائزیشن کو چلا رہا ہو جو قانونی طور سے رجسٹرڈ ہے جو قانون کو ماننے والے ہیں جو دستور کو ماننے والے ہیں آپ اسے پریشان کریں ان کے کاموں کو روکیں ان کے کاموں میں دشواری کھڑا کریں اور قانون کی دھجی ادھیریں دستور کو بھی پامال کریں دستور کے روح کو بھی ختم کریں پھر کہیں کہ ہم قانونی حکومت کر رہے ہیں
The first most important is to create a rainbow coalition with All differences would drink like Shiva drank the poison. All differences would drink and make the united front against fascism. Because first and foremost right now is not our differences. First and foremost is to stop fascism and to defeat it. Smash fascism.
These observations and comments reflect the ethos of this great land, which has always shown throughout history the strength and resilience to survive autocracy and dictatorship. Fascism, whether secular or religious, can't find nourishment and succor in this land, as it religiously protects its variety and diversity. The subcontinent must not be the playground of those who trample upon the rights of the people and believe in enforced uniformity. Surely, there is light at the end of the tunnel.